Modified version of Hooke's law. Modified version of Hooke's law states that the stress induced in a material is directly proportional to the strain within its elastic limit. So, stress is proportional to strain. That means sigma is equal to E into epsilon, whereas sigma represents stress in Newton per meter square. E is the modulus of elasticity or Young's modulus with units of Newton per meter square, and epsilon is a strain. It has no unit. So, what is stress? Stress is defined as the force applied to the unit area to produce a change in the shape, volume, or length of a body. Then, stress is equal to force divided by area. So, sigma is equal to F divided by A. The SI unit of stress is a Newton per meter square or Pascal. And what is strain? The strain is a measure of the deformation of a solid when stress is applied to it. Strain is equal to change in length divided by original length, or epsilon is equal to delta L divided by L. Since strain is the ratio of lengths, it is dimensionless and therefore has no units. Now, Young's modulus. Young's modulus, also known as the elastic modulus, is a number that measures the resistance of a material to being elastically deformed. Therefore, Young's modulus is equal to stress divided by strain, or E is equal to sigma divided by epsilon. It is named after the 17th century English physician and physicist Thomas Young. The stiffer a material, the higher its Young's modulus. Stress-strain curve. The stress-strain curve is a graph that shows the change in stress as strain increases. Point O2A. The straight line of O2A represents that the stress is directly proportional to strain. The point A is known as the limit of proportionality. In this phase, as the stress increases, the strain also increases in the same proportion. Point B. The point B is known as the elastic limit. In this region, material returns to its original position when the load acting on it is completely removed. Beyond this point, the material doesn't return to its original position and a plastic deformation starts to appear in it. Point C. Point C is known as the upper yield point. As the load is increased beyond point B, the strain in the material increases rapidly with a very small increase in stress. Hence, the curve formation. Next, we have point D. Point D is called the lower yield point. When we go beyond point C, the strain increases at a high rate. This condition is known as plastic flow. A very small amount of stress is needed to maintain the deformation of the material. Point E. Point E is known as the ultimate stress. Ultimate stress point is the maximum strength that material have to bear stress before breaking. Last but not the least, point F. Point F is the breaking stress. Between the point E and F, the cross-sectional area of the specimen reduces such that neck formation can be seen. At this point, the stress needed to break the specimen is very low, even less than the ultimate stress. Hence, a drop in the curve from E to F is observed. At the breaking stress, the specimen is broken into two. Thus, this point is known as the breaking point, and the stress corresponding to it is known as the breaking stress. why the stress strain curve important? A stress strain graph gives us many mechanical properties such as strength, toughness, elasticity, resilience, and elongation during load. That's all for today. If you like this video, make sure you like, share, and subscribe to the channel. Till the next video, goodbye.